From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice. Here's your host.
Welcome to this JAMA Clinical Reviews podcast. I'm Dr. David Simel, JAMA Associate Editor and Professor Emeritus of Medicine at the Durham Veterans Affairs Medical Center and Duke University. In this podcast, we will be discussing three common oral health conditions. I'm joined today by Eric T. Stoopler, who is a professor of oral medicine at the University of Pennsylvania School of Dental Medicine. Dr. Stoopler is the lead author of a narrative review on this topic published in the March 26, 2024 edition of JAMA. Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you so much for inviting me to speak. It's really an honor and a pleasure. Thank you.
Well, let's get right into it. In your review, you focused on dry mouth, oral candidiasis, and aphthous stomatitis, which are all conditions that a generalist physician might encounter in their patients. And I'd like to talk about dry mouth. What symptoms might a patient report other than just the sense of dryness?
It's a great question. I think the term dry mouth really is encompassing in the sense that it encompasses two terms that we often use in clinical medicine, xerostomia, which is the subjective feeling of dry mouth, and salivary gland hypofunction, which really is an objective reduction in the salivary flow rate. So patients who are experiencing xerostomia often will complain of a dry throat and the need to drink water to facilitate swallowing, while symptoms of salivary gland hypofunction may include difficulty swallowing and speaking, a reported feeling of oral dryness, thirst, and even halitosis.
What are the most common causes for a dry mouth?
Typically, the use of medications are associated with dry mouth. Use of more than three medications per day have been associated with this phenomenon. Obviously, drug effects on the salivary flow depends on a lot of different factors, including drug composition, dosage, drug interactions, and length of treatment. But those medications associated with dry mouth appear to be those with anticholinergic properties, antihypertensives, including diuretics, antihistamines, antipsychotics, medications with sedating properties, and antidepressants as well.
Tell me a little bit about Sjogren's disease.
Sure. So Sjogren's disease is a rheumatic disease that affects multiple glands, including the salivary glands. Patients often have a constellation of symptoms related to dry mouth, dry eyes, perhaps other systemic complaints related to joint pain. But this is one of the most common rheumatologic disorders associated with dry mouth and often requires multidisciplinary care amongst the medical and dental team to provide overall medical and dental health care for patients.
When you have a patient with dry mouth, are there objective ways of diagnosing dryness?
A comprehensive medical and dental history is needed to rule out any potential causes of dry mouth. That intraoral head and neck exam should be performed, but there certainly are validated surveys that are available to assess for dry mouth. Plus, there are objective testing measures, including sialometry, to test for dryness. Another clinical test that's relatively simple to do is to take a mirror, if you have a dental mirror or plastic mirror, put it against the side of a patient's inner cheek and to see if it sticks. If it does stick, that's an indication, at least somewhat subjectively, that there is some evidence of dry mouth. Also, looking at the floor of the mouth under the tongue to see if there's any degree of salivary pooling. If there isn't, that's also a clinical sign that there may be evidence of dry mouth.
I think all of us recognize that certain medications can cause dry mouth, and we can review medications to try to eliminate those that might be contributing. But are there specific things we can offer our patients to relieve symptoms from a dry mouth?
There are many over-the-counter salivary substitutes or sialagogues that patients can try. There are so many different products out there in local pharmacies, available online through different resale outlets. Recommend patients to drink water, stay hydrated. They may consider use of a humidifier in their sleeping environment. They may consider other types of oral health products that will promote lubrication of their oral cavity, as well as maintaining dental health. We also could consider, in the appropriate clinical situation, prescribing medication that patients may take on a daily basis. Two of the medications that are available by prescription include pilocarpine as well as sevimeline. Both of these medications can promote salivary production and salivary flow. They also do have potential side effects, so it needs to be taken into consideration.
Well, let's switch to oral candidiasis, which we all recognize can be an opportunistic infection. And the salivary hypofunction that you just mentioned can be one of those risk factors. Tell us what's actually going on that allows candida to become a clinical infection.
Well, the development of oral candidiasis typically involves an imbalance in the oral cavity microflora, which favors candida overgrowth, typically in a compromised host immune system. And this can be due to a variety of different factors, including use of corticosteroids, patients with HIV or acquired immune deficiency syndrome, patients taking antibiotics, patients with various oral mucosal disorders. All of these things can contribute to overgrowth of yeast to result in a clinical infection.
When I examine a patient with candidiasis, it can be more than just a white lesion in the mouth. Can you describe the various forms that candida might take?
So as you mentioned, the most common clinical presentation are the white curd-like pseudomembranes that you may see on the inner linings of the cheeks, the soft palate, the tongue. We know this as pseudomembranous candidiasis, but certainly it can present in other clinical forms, including erythematous or atrophic candidiasis, which really comprises a group of clinical manifestations that are characterized by localized or diffuse red and or smooth mucosal surfaces, again, occurring on the different intraoral locations, as we previously discussed. A common example of this is denture stomatitis, where patients may develop these types of infections under removable dentures. Another form of the condition, less common than the other two that we described, is hyperplastic candidiasis, and that results from typically a chronic infection in which a white plaque forms that typically cannot be rubbed off of the mucosal surface. So some people may actually interpret this as a leukoplakic lesion, which wouldn't necessarily be incorrect, but further investigation would have to be done to determine if this is a hyperplastic candidiasis situation.
Is there ever a role for a generalist physician to culture the mucosa for candida?
So most infections are diagnosed clinically. However, there are cases where it may be unclear or maybe similar looking to other types of oral conditions. So if available, exfoliative cytologic smears or imprint stain with giemsa or periodic acid shift can confirm the presence of candida hyphae in the epithelial cell. So that is typically done for cases where it is difficult to make the clinical diagnosis. As I mentioned earlier, biopsy is usually indicated for those patients with hyperplastic candidiasis to rule out other sources or other etiologies as to why the patient developed a white plaque that isn't easily removable in the oral cavity.
Well, you mentioned some risk factors, and one of them was dentures. What can the denture wearer do to decrease the risk of developing candida?
One of the best things to do is to maintain ideal denture hygiene, and that would be at the direction of their dentist, whether it's a cleaning product that the particular individual uses or some other method of maintaining denture hygiene. Also to remove the dentures from their mouth while sleeping to give the oral tissues a chance to quote unquote rest and to have an opportunity to sort of rebalance the oral flora. Those would probably be the two best ways to reduce the risk of developing denture stomatitis.
How do we treat oral candidiasis?
The most common way to treat oral candidiasis is with use of topical antifungal agents. And if you refer to the clinical guidelines that were produced by the Infectious Disease Society of America, they recommend starting with medications such as nystatin and or clotrimazole troches. Most oral candida infections are responsive to these topical medications. They have minimal side effects for patients and they're generally well tolerated. However, in patients that don't respond to topical antifungal therapy, one could consider prescribing a systemic antifungal, the most common being fluconazole. However, fluconazole does have significant side effects, and so the clinician would have to weigh the risk-benefit of placing a patient on this medication.
When you're using a topical treatment in an immunocompetent patient, how quickly should they respond?
You should see results probably within the first week. We generally recommend a 1 to 2 week course of the medication, but usually within the first week of therapy, patients will see a significant improvement in their condition.
Well, let's discuss the third condition that you reviewed, aphthous stomatitis. What does a patient with this report, and what do the lesions look like?
Patients typically report recurrent episodes of painful oral ulcers that typically appear on the cheeks, tongue, inner part of the lips, floor of the mouth that may be triggered by a variety of factors. These ulcers clinically are characterized by a painful round or oval area of ulceration, typically smaller than a centimeter in diameter, often covered by a gray-white fibrin layer encircled by an erythematous ring. This is typically diagnostic for recurrent aphthous stomatitis.
Well, you noted in your review that most cases are idiopathic, but what is the differential diagnosis for these?
Aphthous stomatitis is often confused to some degree with oral HSV or herpes infection because they do have similar aspects clinically. Oral HSV infection is characterized by gingival erythema and may be associated with prodromal symptoms prior to the mucosal vesicles and ulcers. Also, recurrent HSV lesions typically affect the carotenized mucosa, whereas aphthous stomatitis or aphthous ulcers are typically not accompanied by fever or vesicles, typically appearing on the non-carotenized oral mucosa, such as those described before, like the tongue and the lips and the cheek. And so often what I see in practice is patients already using antiviral medications, such as, for example, valacyclovir, with little to no benefit with their aphthous ulcers. And so to me as a clinician, that gives me some guidance as to this is unlikely a viral infection.
When patients have aphthous stomatitis, you noted that they recur. What is the pattern of recurrence?
It's interesting because it is different from individual to individual. Some individuals may report one episode every 3 to 4 months, perhaps once a year, where others will report recurrences almost on a daily to weekly basis. So it can vary significantly from individual to individual. Some individuals may only have 1 to 2 ulcers that develop. Others may have literally a mouthful of ulcers, which really can be quite debilitating in terms of symptoms, in terms of nutritional intake, in terms of diminishing their quality of life. Every patient does present slightly differently.
Is there anything you can take to prevent recurrent stomatitis?
So one of the things that we often do is to do a thorough medical workup of our patients who present with aphthous stomatitis, particularly those who are presenting perhaps with an initial episode in their second or third decades of life. We want to rule out any systemic diseases that may be contributing to the presentation of the aphthous ulcers, including things like celiac disease, Behçet's disease, various types of inflammatory bowel disease, iron deficiency anemia, as well as nutritional deficiencies, such as reduced levels of vitamin B12, folic acid, ferritin, vitamin D, and zinc. And so we want to make sure that we are addressing any potential systemic disorder that could be contributing to their disorder, but also we do recommend using medications to manage the aphthous stomatitis, whether it be mild in nature, which would be amenable to topical corticosteroids. In more severe cases with more frequent recurrence, we may want to consider placing patients on systemic medicine to help prevent recurrence of the disorder, as opposed to using topical steroids to manage the ulcers when they are present.
What are the systemic medications that work?
Medications that are effective for reducing or eliminating recurrences include medicines that are really off-label usage for the medicines, including medicines like pentoxifilin. We also consider colchicine as a systemic medication. We could consider using short courses of systemic corticosteroids to help reduce the burden of disease relatively quickly, and then consider perhaps one of these other medications as maintenance to prevent recurrence of the aphthous ulcers.
When a patient has a recurrence, you mentioned treating them with corticosteroids. when we do that, are we just treating symptoms, or does that actually decrease the duration of the lesions?
It can do both. It can help alleviate symptoms, but also increase the speed in which these lesions will heal. And so it can work for both purposes.
And what is the typical response for this sort of treatment?
When patients are placed on systemic corticosteroids for aphthous ulcers, we see responses very quickly, usually within 1 to 2 days. So that is a very good outcome typically when using systemic corticosteroids.
Well, Dr. Stoopler, is there anything else you would like our listeners to know about these three oral conditions?
Absolutely. There are representative photographs of all of these oral conditions in the article. So I would recommend to review those photographs to get a good sense of what these lesions appear to be clinically. Dry mouth, oral candidiasis, and recurrent aphthous stomatitis are common, and they may be associated with patient discomfort, decreased quality of life, as well as morbidity. And it's important for generalists to identify and address these conditions as they feel appropriate, as well as consider referral to dental and/or medical specialists for further evaluation and management when necessary.
Well, thank you, Dr. Stoopler, for joining us today to talk about dry mouth, oral candidiasis, and aphthous stomatitis. This episode was produced by Shelley Steffens at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com. Thanks for listening.